Hi, and welcome to the World Beyond Belief. My name is Paul Marco, and have I got a treat for you. We've been working with this woman for about, I guess, 2 or 3 weeks. We've had many encounters, many long talks, and she's a real treat for you. She's very interesting, and she's very deep down the rabbit hole. Some of you who have just started to awaken may not be able to follow her, because she knows deep wisdom. But just stick with us, and I think you'll find her totally fascinating. She's an amazing writer, and I hope that I'm put on the list for the publication of her first book. That's got to be outstanding. I've read a lot of her writing, and she's very organized, and she's very interesting, very fascinating. She has a deep story. Now, since I've been working with her, we've encountered, her tormentor, one of her perps. Remember yesterday on the forum, we talked about Millicent Black's perpetrator who is inside of her head, talking to her all the time. Well, this woman, Lydia, has a very mean one. And you'll probably get to know him by the comments below. He's really a sicko. I look forward to reading that. Also, she's interesting in that she straddles two cultures, and she has deep wisdom for both cultures, the Lakota indigenous culture in the United States, and of course our Western American culture. And she pulls from both cultures. So it's going to be a very fascinating interview. She's very good at synthesizing wisdom from both. So before I talk away my whole hour, let me introduce you to Lydia Whitecalf. Lydia, hi.
Hi, Paul. Thank you so much. It's nice to be here. So before I introduce myself, I'm going to ask a asymmetrical question about history, because we're in an asymmetrical war. So this question may seem odd to people, but the purpose for it will be evidenced in the unfolding interview. So my question to you is, post World War II, you and I and the rest of the world know the history of, you know, what's called modern warfare, post-World War II. We know about all the wars, covert and overt, those of us that do know about the covert wars. So we know about Vietnam, right? We know about South America, El Salvador, Nicaragua, Chile, Argentina, et cetera. We know about the African continent, most of those covert, but Angola, Mozambique, Rhodesia, et cetera. And I'm not necessarily referring to the genocides. We know then we move into the Middle East theater. We know about Afghanistan, Iraq, the first Gulf War, et cetera, correct? So is it fair to say that you and I know about all the wars that happened in the world, around the world? Is there any war that, is there any continent I've left out that there was an official, by definition, which will be defined, an official war, even if it was covert? Is there a continent I've left out?
Not that I can think of.
So there's, you've never, I mean, would it sound crazy if I said that there was a war in North America to North Americans? I mean, you'd write me off as crazy, right?
Most people would. I wouldn't, because I know where you're going with this.
Well, okay. It's nice to meet you. My name is Lydia Whitecalf. And just a brief, because my past isn't relevant compared to this story, but I was a journalist, a photojournalist, based in Asia almost 10 years, starting at the age of 21. In fact, my first story was Cambodia. as the million refugees were spilling over the border. So I was on the border in between four armies and a million refugees. That was my first story. So I worked for global press and magazines around the world, a brief 3 years back in America at the end of that, working for the Miami Herald based. I lived in Palm Beach. And I might say here that this is always attacked, that I come from that society. I come from that 1%. By my parents' generation, there wasn't direct involvement in the power structure, just the friends and family. So I grew up being exposed to in that culture, and that I think somewhat prepared me and gave me insights that other people don't have. I had to have lunch with Queen Elizabeth when I was 16, where I disappeared to the bathroom and smoked Thai weed the whole time. And I really couldn't handle the interactions with the European aristocracy, the lords and ladies, or on the other side of the family, my father's, it was meetings with Kissinger, Khrushchev. His best friend ran the White House, though no one knows that, behind Gerald Ford. And I can talk about that some other time if anybody wants me to talk about that before I get labeled. But his name was Rogers C.B. Morton. That was my father's best friend. And anyone can Google that. My father's name is Peter Hirschloff. So Uncle Raj ran the White House for about 3 years after Nixon was impeached. So I was in and out of the Oval Office with that side of the family, and grew up in Palm Beach and Hope Sound and a secret island in the Bahamas, with rubbing shoulders with the Bushes, the Harrimans, and always terrorized and mortified. So that's my background. By 1993, I was working on two really important, huge projects, one of which was mine alone that regarded fetal alcohol syndrome. It was endorsed by US senators and the top specialists in the field. So it was a major project that was going to be a book and a film. And I was also working with a famous director at Viacom by the name of Robert Altman, not to be confused with the Robert Altman filmmaker, but in his own right, that's Googleable. Someone I'd grown up with anyway, so we were good friends. We were putting together a pilot series for Viacom because I was now being asked by the leading expert in the field of fetal alcohol syndrome based out of Seattle to go to the worst case, go photograph the worst case in the country, a little boy in a place called Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. At which point Bob Altman and I began the treatment and the research for what was going to be a television series on Viacom called The New Indian Wars. So with both, that gave me the funding to get to Pine Ridge, and I worked on both projects simultaneously. I arrived in October 1993. And in hindsight, I'll say that the day I met the little boy's father that I was there to photograph. Now, this father adopted the little boy when he was six months old. The little boy's name was Rocky Whitecalf. And the father, it took me 3 weeks to find him, his name is Royce Whitecalf. So in hindsight, the day I met Royce, which was October, end of October 1993, my targeting began. However, I've split that targeting into three categories, which I'll get to in the second hour. And the full-blown going from surveillance only to the all-out, it's no longer just surveillance, it's into the tactics of counterintelligence, And we have to ask it about JSOC and JTTF to the point of assassination. It's not just all the other tactics of destroy the marriage, destroy the finances, tie up in court, terrorize PSYOPs, everything under the sun. That begins in 1998. So now, returning to that question I asked you, we all know there was no such thing as a war in North America to North Americans. I'm going to present a book, and this is called Agents of Repression, written by who we now know to be a key Department of Justice, FBI agent, CIA, FBI agent by the name of Ward Churchill, posed as an Indian and laid out in this really important work by Jim Keith, for which he was murdered, we assume. In this book are the citations of the CIA themselves in developing the idea that university professors are going to be the best disguise across the country for either what we call NOCs, which is an acronym for not officially covert agents, or men that go by their actual identity, men and women. In this case, I am assuming this is a NOC, because he really did a number on two groups. But I'm here just to talk not about the Black Panthers in chains as slaves, but about the Indians in the 70s as in chains. So I establish up front that why these agents write their own books like this that are fully cited. It's a journalistic masterpiece. Citations, the indexes at the back third of the book, is because they serve a purpose as a manual. It's a manual for other ops around the world. So that's why they write and publish these books. It's posed as, I'm on your side, I'm a part of the American Indian movement, I'm an Indian, which is proven he's not. I write this to the public as a journalist and a college professor to expose, it's that classic humanitarian disguise and cover. But nonetheless, there's nowhere else recorded the real facts, because you won't find them on a wiki and you won't find them in any other books, short of the few men and women that came out of the situation on Pine Ridge. Other than their books, Russell Means, Dennis Banks, you won't find the kind of, and Peter Matheson, for what happened. So I'm going to read from the man that was in charge of the operation himself, that documented every step and answer that question, was there a war in North America, that we would all say, of course there's not a war like Vietnam or Chile or Guatemala in North America. Of course not. Well, here we go. And then once I read this, I'm going to read a few chapters. I'm going to return to putting this in a stark context. So I open with the subcategory of the final chapter, of the chapter that begins with the American Indian Movement, called Garden Plot and Cable Splicer. This is a word I found in this book, which describes MKUltra and the engineering of Western civilization, and the re-engineering, and in this very important book that I'll get back to. There's mention of Operation Garden Plot in all three. So what I'm here to tell you is we are part of Operation Garden Plot. This is not just about political, so-called political groups in the 60s. this is the whole global population. So so I begin with the first paragraph. The issue of the FBI relationship to the goons, and I'll pause here to break down the acronym of GOON. GOON is the Guardians of the Oglala Lakota Nation. Let me pause briefly and say that this is the blueprint of Operation Phoenix. This is the model where wherever we land in a counterinsurgency response, even before we're going to, a coup has happened, we need to take out the political opposition, the purpose of surveillance. So as we are in the process of taking out political opposition before any event, weather event or a coup, political event, we've already recruited, compromised through sexual pedophilia control files, key members of the population of the country or province or area that are corruptible and that will then join our counterinsurgency death squads. In this case, in Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, starting in 1972, that's the case with what we are told to call the goons. These were no longer full bloods, they were corruptible, and that there are many, many other ways to corrupt besides pedophilia and control files. And I believe that's some satanic ritual, et cetera. So when I say goons, we now know that we're talking about a force on Pine Ridge of half breeds. These are usually the people that you know, have forgotten half their identity and will turn against their own, as did, you know, as is the case in most covert wars, El Salvador, Nicaragua, etc. So let me continue. The issue of the FBI relationship to the goons on Pine Ridge becomes all the more acute when viewed in the context of being part of a COINTELPRO era, that's an acronym for counterintelligence, scenario calling for the active domestic collaboration of the Bureau, the CIA, the military, and other federal local assets of repression in a combination the church committee had condemned as being inappropriate and illegal. This is directly contrary to the termination of such activities recommended by the committee, which received solemn assurance from the respective agencies that it had long been ended. A review of government documents declassified by court order reveals that the overall script guiding federal performance on Pine Ridge during the critical period may be found in a top secret Pentagon plan for domestic counterinsurgency, operation codenamed Garden Plot. This was produced during the late 1960s, a subsection of the broader cable splicer study commissioned by the Pentagon's Directorate of Military Support. In essence, the Garden Plot scenario called for the training of civilian police, and this is a word I'm going to talk a lot about, police, at an Army's senior officials disturbance center orientation course at Fort Gordon, and the establishment of the biggest and most important word, special operations groups, SOG'S. So we'll get back to SOG'S. From among key non-military personnel nationally, these would be deployed as centerpieces to law enforcement endeavors, focusing upon the suppression of dissidents whenever and wherever dissent in the United States was deemed to have gotten out of hand. Advice and tactical consultation to these non-military formations would accrue directly from the military's irregular, asymmetrical warfare specialist. Specialized counterinsurgency equipment would be provided directly by the military, and in the event that a given situation ultimately overshot the repressive capacities of the non-military collaborators. Special counterinsurgency trained military units would be deployed to finish the job. Tellingly, the term SOG is synonymous with the identification of a secret unit comprised of the U.S. Special Army Forces and other elite personnel, CIA operatives, and the elite elements of the South Vietnamese police military, then functioning in Southeast Asia and eventually tied to the infamous Operation Phoenix assassination program undertaken there. Another hallmark of this classified special warfare consortium was its use of mercenary and other unorthodox troop formations, such as the Montagnards, Khmer Rouge, and Nungs, to which pseudo-gangs, such as the Klan, SAO, and I can revisit SAO later, and goons would be the domestic equivalent. Moving on to the next highlighted chapter. The garden plot cable splicer prospectus accords well with Journey. Attorney General Richard Kleindienst dispatch of SWAT-trained FBI personnel and a 65-man SOG, Special Operations Group, from the U.S. Marshals Service to Pine Ridge on February 12, 1973, as well as the involvement of the Pentagon in the persons of Colonel Volney Warner and Jack Potter, sent by Alexander Haig. Warner's credentials for the job included former counterinsurgency training at the U.S. Special Army Warfare School in Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and two tours in Vietnam. He was now on his way to Pine Ridge, specializing in application of counterinsurgency doctrine. His second tour was with Civil Affairs and Pacification programs associated with Operation Phoenix. Warner countered a proposal advanced by Joseph Trimbach and U.S. Marshal Director Wayne Colburn, made during a secret meeting between the three at Ellsworth Air Force Base near Rapid City, South Dakota, during the early morning hours of March 3rd, 1973, that 2,000 troops would be immediately introduced to the reservation. The colonel suggested that they continue to increase the size of FBI and Marshal forces, and he would give them the military supplies necessary to do the job. If it failed, the 82nd Airborne Division would come to their rescue. We can return to exactly what the 82nd Airborne is, but for anybody that knows military language, that's our finest, most important today, Air Command, today. So he would later compare the military's role at Wounded Knee to that of the Military Assistance and Advisory Command in Vietnam.
When the shutdown operations in Vietnam, they just transferred it over to internal United States.
To U.S. citizens.
Yeah.
I'll get to that, why they're U.S. citizens. So just two more quick paragraphs. By March 4th, there were, again, 243 federal officers surrounding Wounded Knee, which is a gravesite and a small church in the middle of nowhere with a tiny housing cluster half a mile away that's 20 units. That had nothing to do with this incident. Okay, so again, 243 federal officers surrounded this tiny church, a figure that grew to over 300 by March 12th. Corresponding provisions of military material included, quote, over 130 M16 rifles with 100,000 rounds of ammunition, 75 high-powered sniper rifles, M14s, M1s, and Springfields, all with scopes and ammunition. Helmets, flak vests, signal flares, mine detectors, C rations, jeeps, trucks, maintenance, technicians for the APCs, On April 12th, the FBI via the Justice Department followed up by requesting a pre-positioned package of military equipment, including, quote, 200 baseball-type CS gas grenades, M79 grenade launchers with 100 rounds of high explosives, 600 rounds of CS gas, and 600 rounds of red smoke, usually used as markers and targeting airstrikes, 750 pounds of dry CS and air delivery canisters, helicopters, and additional military advisors. The request was approved by the Defense Department on April 17, 1973, and pre-positioned at Fort Carson, Colorado, rather than at Ellsworth Air Force Base, as the Bureau had requested. We can summarize why. It was this military logistics support which allowed federal forces to pour more than 500,000 bullets into Wounded Knee Church in 71 days. Simultaneously, Fred Buzhardt, general counsel for the Defense Department, had prepared, according to a 19th presidential advisor John Ehrlichman, to actor Marlon Brando, a memo to Nixon recommending the full-scale invasion of Pine Ridge, utilizing tanks, a minimum of a division of troops, 15,000 to 17,000 men. It must be remembered that all this military might was focused upon less than 300 American Indian Movement members, i.e. Indian people. Indians. People, let's remove the movement label, and supporters inside Wounded Knee Church. It must also be recalled that all this accumulated military hardware, once in the hands of the FBI, remained there for the duration of its exercise on Pine Ridge, which I'm here to tell you lasted until 1986, with 5 years of which was under martial law. A matter readily evidenced by the APCs and Bell UH-1B Huey helicopters consistently utilized by the Bureau on the reservation during the summer and fall of 1975. The situation on Pine Ridge closely resembled the conditions of death squad repression prevailing in Latin America. The FBI's fostering and use of pseudo-gangs or private armies, especially in the context of its secret cooperation with the military in pursuit of its covert political agendas. So let me pause. Covert political agendas, i.e. resources on the reservation, uranium. It was found that the Indians were put on the worst land in America because it seemed to be the worst land. The worst land, later shows in the 1930s, is where all the resources are. It's desert and rock, i.e. Middle East. So there's coal, oil, earthy ground of the now in the 1930s, Indian reservations. So when they say, in pursuit of its covert political agendas, we're talking about the corporate boards of Exxon and the uranium corporations, and we're talking about corporations and banks. So I'll continue the sentence. Truly seems to approximate the situation in such countries, what happened in Pine Ridge, as Uruguay or Guatemala. In a domestic scene sense, the role of FBI on Pine Ridge corresponds precisely with that of the special forces in Southeast Asia, and that of the goons to the Montagnard and other indigs, the local people, of the Green Berets equipped and led there. So I'll stop there with reading from this book. And now I can ask the audience of the world, was there a war, by all definitions, in North America post-World War II?
And we have to say yes.
So there was a war.
I just posted an article yesterday. It says that this same thing is happening over the Golan Heights, and that's why the deep state is motivated by a company called Genie. You know what I'm talking about?
Genie Energy.
genie energy to get to Golan Heights. That's the whole idea of the Syrian war.
Exactly. So, Murdoch.
So wagging the dog again.
Dick Cheney, Murdoch, Rumsfeld. Of course, Rothschild at the Golan Heights, genie energy, and the drilling facilities have already been built, you know, west of the Golan Heights. So the refinery, I guess, the facility. So, and I first read about that, what, 2 or 3 years ago, genie energy. So, yeah. So, okay. I need to just return quickly to historic context, because most Americans don't know that there are Native Americans in North America. They don't know what a reservation is. This is what I've found being married for 23 years to this nation called the Lakota Nation, to an Indian. This is what I've found. I rarely, it's maybe a handful of times have I run into anybody. And I'm just south of South Dakota, where there's the politically correct in Boulder, Colorado. So I've rarely found anybody that even knows their, you know, what an Indian is, what a reservation is, let alone, and with the passing of generations toward the millennial, forget it, that what is the Battle of Custer, which we learned in first grade. You know, we knew who Crazy Horse was, and we were taught this in history. In our generation, I'm 58, that doesn't exist anymore. And, you know, I've been asking people as I get older, who are the younger generations, for 20 years, all the way through to now the 18-year-olds, and, you know, it's what battle? Custer? What, you know, completely written out of history. So since it's written out of history, I'll present the following really brief, really brief history. And I'm really just focusing on the Lakota Nation. So I will say up front that I have found that there's a pattern around the world, and it's part of my research anyway, into what we call another misnomer, indigenous peoples, that their nations are comprised of seven bands. And I've been asking why. Why do I keep seeing this? No different here in North America or Canada with the native peoples here. And I have the answer to that now. So that's the you know, for the interview and the book I'm writing. So we're dealing with seven bands, and let's go to the 1860s. So by the mid 1860s, the U.S. government that is now in existence is fighting the Civil War, which ends in 1965. So a tremendous amount of troops and generals, et cetera, what we had then as our army, are tied up in the Civil War. That ends in 65. But there were ongoing wars to the remaining great tribes at the frontier. By then, the frontier is the Missouri River. So we can say from the Missouri River to California, it's war to the great native tribes, all the way to California. And I'm just going to talk about the Lakota. Now, I know from historic fact that I can provide that the nation that was impossible to defeat, no matter what the U.S. government did, was the Lakota Nation. There was one other nation that presented the same problem. That was the Apache. But I'm just going to state that and stay concise and move back to history. The Lakota Nation, they were undefeatable. So by the end, undefeatable, that there was nothing that could take down the men and women of this nation, the warriors. So by the end of the Civil War, the whole force of the U.S. military was then focused on the Lakota Nation. I won't say, I'm not going to talk about the history of the other nations, the Cheyenne and Nez Perce, etc., for the purposes of this interview. So I'm just going to talk about the Lakota. The Lakota got a particular psychopath, a sociopath, historically. And to return at this time in 1868, that we know as Custer, General Custer. And he was sent with the 7th Cavalry to finish off the job by all means necessary, with the assistance of other generals that had, you know, won the Civil War. So they're in the background, but a battle ensues in Montana in what's called the Little Bighorn, where Custer suffers a horrible defeat. This was to be the definitive deciding battle to kill the remaining leaders of the Indians, mostly Lakota. There was Cheyenne involvement in this famous historic battle of 1868, but what did happen was Custer was killed, and most of the 7th Cavalry were destroyed. And now the U.S. government had a real problem, because that's all the force they had. They're freed up from the Civil War, and they still can't take these Lakotas down and the 7 bands. And at that point, they assigned a post the defeat of the famous Battle of Little Bighorn in 1868. They assigned 1,000 cavalry, that's 1,000 men, blue coats, whatever you want to call them, per warrior. They just deemed in Washington it would take 1,000 white men, and I don't mean that racially. So 1,000 of them to take down one Lakota warrior. And again, this is where I really am, it's the focus of my book and any further interviews, because that's the truth we all need to know, that's the truth about ourselves. Our true spiritual potential, our true human potential. We all, this is why there is such a knee jerk over continuing today, over the nasty comment you saw under my name today, that no less a knee jerk than a post-Custer terror from Washington, from the establishment, from the bankers behind the scenes, from the entire top of the pyramid establishment. The real enemy, the real threat, are in fact what we've been told, brainwashed relentlessly, are the savages, the heathens, the drunkard Indians. In fact, they appear in history so little, we're usually told about the slaves. The slaves are safe to talk about because they do not have a land base. And that's what that's the biggest cover-up of history of the last 9,000 years, that land base. So that we can continue.
Let me interject just one thing. To me, when we first went over this, Lydia, it sounded like our materialistic culture against a more spiritual based culture. And it's very threatening to this heavily materialistic enslavement culture to have this. You can tell about it better than me, but absolutely, that's the way I conceptualized it when we first went
over. Absolutely. I mean, I don't really want to, you know, go into a tangent, but I'll briefly say that the big secret to human existence is the connection between a living organism that has esoteric principles, whether the Indians are defining it for themselves or some kooky alternative archaeologists are finding evidence all over the world, that where we're born or where we land is by natural law, and that's a whole other subject, but by a different kind of law, the diametrically opposed law that we know in Western civilization today that says it's law, whether it starts with Moses's Ten Commandments or we fast forward to Treaty of Westphalia, where nation states are declared legal entities, to Magna Carta, etc. These historic moments that now are defining law, which Indian people will say is man-made law, and the powers that we'll call the Illuminati or the New World Order, whatever word you want to use, the Satanic beast system, that's the heart of their fight, is destroying this basic information that the land is as much a communicating, living source of spiritual and conscious information to us in our groupings called nations, the real nations, with us receiving from a cosmological, we're the intermediary in between, the human. And it's not that the other, as the Lakota would say, the other nations, which are the two-leggeds, other than the two-leggeds, the four-leggeds, the wings, the all that crawls and swims, the standing people, with everything that grows in photosynthesis, the trees, grasses, etc., and the grandfather rock, which is the oldest brother. So we receive from both above and below, and we will find that the Illuminati blueprint for their satanic calendar that I saw you, review in a video recently about the year 2016 satanic ritual dates, they're using those dates. And I'll explain later in another video why those dates, what's up with the keeping of knowledge of astronomy and why it's a source of power. So that aside, returning to the history, post Custer's defeat, they're sending all the big guns. And as I said, now 1,000 cavalrymen per warrior. Between the period of the defeat of Custer and the 1900s. And I won't go any further into what happens in those 30 years. What I will say is a fort was built in that was called Fort Robinson, which is south west miles to the most southwestern corner of Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. So it's southwest of today's border of the reservation. And at that point, there had been so much unfair war, which is all they do anyway. But Kit Carson had been busy piling up 6 million buffalo skulls. There's pictures of that online. That they were systematically taking away all the food, killing all the horses, massacring in the most horrific manner whenever, wherever they could. And they had been doing that since Columbus and Cortez. So we really need to always say, and Cortez. That's my idea. I'm not borrowing that from anybody. I recently found out about Cortez and Cortez. So since Columbus and Cortez, this has been the worst human butchery in all of human history, because we're talking about a hemisphere. So it's not 50 million or 100 million. It's so much more. The number's too high to count, but you know, the entire population of a hemisphere, which is Canada, North America, South America, from tip to tip, were butchered in massacres. So in those next 30 years post Custer's defeat, there was, you know, massacres going on everywhere, And when we say massacre, you and I probably know, and there's evidence of particular massacres here, that, you know, pregnant women have their stomachs pierced open with the bayonet, and the baby, the fetus is plucked out and paraded around, and the genitals are carved off and made into saddle horn trophies. And I'm not talking in a few events. This is the general rule, coast to coast all along. The skinning of Indians. We have many, many Bibles. One just appeared in a museum in Denver. That's Indian skin Bible. And long pig was a delicacy since Columbus arrived, of Indian meat in Europe, the black market, right up to the 1900s. And I would hate to think it was still going on today, but
Well, we know that cannibalism is running rampant.
Exactly.
Hand in hand with the pedophilia. The one thing I do remember from, I think it was the Bury My Heart of Wounded Knee book, was the white people making tobacco pouches out of the breasts of the women. It stuck me to this day. I probably read that in 1975.
Yeah.
So this is horrible atrocities. It's right up there with Stalin massacring 60 million. But this happens over such a long period of time, and it's probably still happening today.
It is. It is. And that's part of my story, which if there's any detail, time for details of my story, that would be in the second hour. But no, it is. And that's part of the story. I lived it. So along with Bill Clinton, who was on Pine Ridge in 1999, and my husband, this was over more butchered bodies, but by the White County sheriffs on the border in 1999. This just was 1999.
What, so Bill Clinton, what are you doing there?
Oh, well, I can get to that. Okay. It's the ongoing serial killing, right, perpetrated by...
I don't want to interrupt your flow. I'm just totally fascinated.
Back to history. So by the late 1880s, there was a phenomenon happening called the ghost dance. Again, I won't go into defining that and why that was so threatening, more than anything, to the U.S. government. Why is, we're told Indians, are savages that go around in circles and woo, No. This is threatening. This is the threat. The ghost dance. So again, that's for another interview. But the ghost
dance. I do want to interject about the ghost dance.
Okay.
This spiritual community doing what they were reaching out to their spirits to get rid of the white men. The whole idea of that ceremony was to push the white men back because they couldn't live with them. You probably have a lot more detailed information, and we can get it another time. But
yeah.
it was a spiritual exercise.
It's spiritual powers.
Right.
You're absolutely right. So the ghost dance was the final straw, and it was also the perfect pretext. There was a band, a chief that was coming to return to Fort Robinson, that was chosen as the spot to start rounding up the great chiefs and their, the fragments of the bands slowly coming in after Custer's defeat to Fort Robinson. Where a lot of horrible things were happening. And it still stands today as a museum. It's where they murdered Crazy Horse. But because of its proximity, because it was originally called, it's in an area that was called by both parties the Pine Ridge. Because on the east slope of the Black Hills, is an extension of ridges down into prairie. So we're in the middle of that extension of ridges on the east and south side of the Black Hills, where Fort Robinson is built. And all the chiefs had basically chosen Red Cloud to be the ultimate, you know, voice of leadership in these final year in decades. And in fact, Red Cloud, who is Oglala, went to Washington to have a private meeting with President Grant. That didn't happen. I think there was only one or two other events where any chiefs went to the White House, but he went alone. This is the Lakota. So Red Cloud said in those 20 years, while the ghost dancing was beginning, to all the people of not just the Lakota, the Cheyenne, to all the other chiefs, start coming in. There's no chance. There's no other way. We have to begin to surrender. They're offering us these things called the treaties. There was two treaty signings with the Lakota. One, the most recent was 1868 in Fort Laramie, just south of Fort Robinson. So the famous 1868 treaty is in dispute today when we see the No Dapple protesters in North Dakota all last winter. That they are talking about that treaty. That's their land by that treaty. So this is still going on, you know. This war is still never stopped, evidenced by the Dakota Access Pipeline issue that the whole world now saw this winter in North Dakota. So that is where we get the idea of the word Pine Ridge, because Fort Robinson is in the area of the ridges, which are pine covered. And long story short, there's a chief coming from the northeast toward Fort Robinson, and he camps at a place called Wounded Knee. And his name is Chief Bigfoot. And he arrives in 1891 on his way to surrender, and he has with him 300 exhausted, which says a lot. It's a lot to exhaust humans in their full potential, women, children, elderly, mostly elderly people. So they camp. There's about 300. They set up camp in a creek system, because the Lakota and other nations camp in winter along creek systems, called the Wounded Knee Creek, which today is in the heart of what we now know as the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. So this is why, okay, so then what happens is they've just arrived. He's dying of pneumonia. This is 1891. On December 27th, again, a very esoteric date that we all know about from the dark side of the force, just after the resurrection of the sun. The 7th Cavalry, renewed and built since Custer's death 20-some years earlier, is allowed to have its revenge. They surround Bigfoot's encampment and open fire with cannons and rifles. They massacre. That there were a few, maybe 20, 27 survivors. In the snow of the plains of South Dakota, in a place called Wounded Knee. A large mass grave is dug, it's filmed, it's photographed, it's everywhere online for a reason, but it's really photographed, this large mass grave. And, the men standing in it, it's way over their heads as they're, you know, receiving the bodies and just piling them up 4 or 5 days after the massacre, because they left them out in the freezing blizzard that then it's began the night of the massacre. Once it was over, a great blanket of snow fell. Anyway, they put the 271 bodies into that mass grave. At some time afterward, a church was built back and behind the mass grave on a knoll. And that's this little church called Wounded Knee Church. And eventually, by the sometime in the 20s or 30s, a little tiny trading post was built next to it for tourists called Gildersleeves. So it had stocks of meat and rice and some trinkets for tourists. We're going to call these great spiritual objects trinkets now, whether they're, you know, headdresses or, you know, sacred instruments are going to be sold at Gildersleeves for $20 or whatever back then, less, $2. They're up for sale at Gildersleeves. So conditions by the mid-1950s. So just a brief mention. Into my, you know, I'm about to get to the second hour. So about the turn of the 1900s, the event of the massacre of Wounded Knee. It's not just the Lakota that suffer a collective breaking. It's all Native people on this continent. It was the collective breaking. Spiritual breaking, the heart broke. All resistance died. Everybody surrendered. Those that already had east of the Missouri, it was no less felt. It is no less felt today. So for them, and the U.S. government knows this, for all remaining 565 tribes, a good misnomer, left today with treaty status here in the United States of America, this becomes the symbol, political and historic, of heartbreak, of the heartbreak, of the defeat, of the surrender. And as we move into the turn of the century, the 1900s, the white man is, you know, everywhere now, on what used to be the most sacred land, the land of freedom, that are now called, they go through a series of names very quickly, so people like you and me won't ever find out what the original names were of the confined lands. Indians were told, ordered by, you know, follow your chief, go to the confined land, they're originally called prisoner of war camps. Pine Ridge was 304, number 304. That's quickly, you know, rearranged into agencies with an agent, who are the most corrupt officials possible to really ensure the continued starvation and no assistance. Now ordered onto a bordered land, if they dare cross that area, they'll be shot and killed. And there are now jails and prisons being built on the inside of these open air prisons that we know today as the reservations. So by the 30s, I believe, the entire system of these open-air prisons all over America are renamed reservations once the minerals are found. Because at one moment I turned to my husband and said, and this wasn't that long ago, 12, 15 years ago, Royce, what does the word reservation mean? He answers, no hesitation, land put aside for further use. Ah, so, you know, we always had that. A sort of language together since the minute we met. Yeah. So it's the guise of treaties and human rights is completely absent on these reservations and that system, and really was evidenced in the first half of the 1900s. Royce was born in 1959, and again, Royce is my husband that I marry in 1993. During those 50s, there are now 4 or 5 generations coming out of what's called the boarding school system here in North America. In Canada, it's called the residential school system, which are Jesuit-run, terrifying, large brick buildings. Every horror to the kidnapped children, age 3 to 4 to 18, 6 generations in a row, and straggling into the next few generations in a much less severe manner are, since the 1980s, are erected everywhere in both Canada and North America. And this is global, but we're just talking about here. So that It's hard to know the statistics of children that do come out alive, but when they come out alive, they're already formed to be goons. They've been so raped and sodomized by the system of priests, hierarchical administrators, and principals. They've witnessed so much murder of their baby brothers and sisters, and they've been so traumatized through satanic ritual and horror, daily mass rape, tyranny, terror, war crimes. These are children. That the ones that are showing signs of I'll tattle are immediately picked out, graduated, and now sent to be the replacement of what was the tribal elder system until the minerals were found in the 30s by Rockefeller. And a new act was passed, because now we're in legislative genocide, that invents a corporate board system called the tribal council system. And the tribal council system is going to be the direct recruits in the boarding schools here and the reserve, the reserve schools in Canada. These, since the 30s, are the survivors of the boarding school system who are in so much trauma and so much entrainment with satanic ritual and heart, you know, that they just now take delight in perpetrating to anybody, but most especially their own people. That this is the ongoing situation since 1934. And by the way, when that oil was discovered on the Navajo reservation by Rockefeller in 1930, and he did go to the Navajo and said, "We need, you know, let's make a deal. You know, we'll give you this. Oh, we want to be able to drill for some oil, and there's some coal, and there's some uranium." And the elders, now rounded up, lied to for 150 years. A deal, you know, because these are still the old elder council system before this legislation. And the elders look at him and say, you're crazy. At his agents that arrive and say, let's make a deal. We'll give you money. We'll give you a little more land. You'll give us what? You'll give us your Bible and more death. No thanks. So, Act of Legislation, 1934, Indian Reorganization Act, and in come the now suit and tie wearing Indian under the very important meme invented by a Utah senator, which is kill the Indian, save the man. So you know, I don't want to go too far into history, but this now, the big nations east of the Missouri who have all these resources suddenly found in the 1930s are all asked, would you negotiate with Washington for, you know, no way. So the legislation that was passed is based on signatures from graveyards. I don't care what nation, Navajo, I don't care, the two biggest land nations in U.S. today are the Navajo and the Lakota. They got their signatures for the congressional legislation from graveyards, from dead people. So out goes the elder council system, which had been in place since time immemorial, and in comes the corporate board system, which is now going to make deals with corporate America and, you know, political America. And this begins in the 30s. So this results in institutionalized poverty, institutionalized ongoing murder, institutionalized racism, institutionalized genocide in every manner. The people are now under by that system of these half-breeds coming out of the boarding schools that were tortured, you know, to that point where they broke. This results in conditions so horrific that Pine Ridge today is second in statistics to Haiti in the entire Western Hemisphere. So my husband's born into not just these statistics of starvation and deprivation. You know, housing hadn't started yet. You know, Indians were, all their tools were taken away. All their guns were collected. They had to figure out ways to, you know, make their timber because they were ordered to build something called a house. In other words, a shack. And they figured it out as best they could, starving between 1900 and the 1950s. And with the their parents coming home from the boarding school system and their aunties and uncles and their grandparents generation by generation. Now, then there is this social horror from hell engineered by the school system going on as well by the returning relatives. So now we have the relatives doing, thank you very much, the most acts of horror to them, to themselves. And that's always the ambition of genocide, you know, get it to a point where we're killing ourselves for them. So this is now what Royce is born into. And by 10, because his memories were so repressed by trauma, he didn't start remembering them until the last few years in this house, did recently. And in the memories he did remember that I've written down by the age of 10 are so horrific, I can never write them or tell of them. I can never, I wouldn't want to hurt you, Paul. It would traumatize you just to hear of a few of them. Of Royce, what Royce, what every Indian is now living by the turn of the 60s, 1960s. Now out here in white America, we have due process. We have right to habeas corpus. We have jury, right to jury by trial of peers. We have right to legal counsel and right to public assembly. And we think everyone in North America does, but not the Indians. They have the opposite. It's still to this day, oh, it's sanctioned. It's not just allowed, it's sanctioned. Go murder an Indian. Go kill it. And that's been going on in North Dakota this winter. You know, and actually there's a longstanding rule with the KKK. If you find one sleeping, cut off the head. And that happened to one of our best friends in Denver and almost my brother who had to go rescue, who fell asleep on a park bench. And this turned into a 40-hour drive to go get my sleeping brother. So his head wouldn't be removed like our friend Mike shot. This is 10 years ago. You know, so in at any bus stop anywhere in America, even to the East Coast, you find a sleeping Indian, and you know, the police will contact KKK, because this has happened in our case. Now, there's one, give the coordinates, and off with the head. So this is now going on into the 60s, Indians being killed, beaten to death for sport, their babies being, you know, killed for sport. This is now Royce can, I have a person, and I've, since the 1993s, I'm hearing it from everybody I'm being married into, as this is, I'm now married to Royce by 1994. And I, you know a lot of people by that time because of the projects I was working on caused me to have to go around and meet everybody anyway. So the elders, the people. So, you know, I'm getting it from the horse's mouth, which is a terrible expression, about the current, you know, this, what was going on in the 60s. One of my uncles by marriage, his mother just fled, and he's alive. He's old because the average male expectancy still today is 44. So Uncle Bruce in Kansas is approaching his late 60s, early 70s, which is unheard of because his mother got him out of there when he was two, and he's a full blood. The white calves are full bloods. So the full bloods, of course, are the highest target. And there's open shooting at any intersection in now what is called the reservation, whether it was Uncle Bruce when he was two, you know, fly-by white vigilante groups, you know, just popping off bullets. Oh, there goes a two-year-old, you know, score, and, you know, celebrate, you know, this is what Royce is born into. This is what all those people are experiencing. So this is not just in the reservations, because there was also another really the duplicitous piece of legislation in the 50s called the Indian Removal Act, which set up a system to force Indians off the reservations and into the cities. And that did happen, to get them away from that land, get them away from each other, and then assimilate, the final assimilation, make them white people in the cities. So that was happening. And the ones that refused to leave and stayed behind are still starving to death. The housing that is finally built is the poorest I've ever seen in the world. And I've been, you know, all over India, Brazil, China. I've been to the classic spots of human poverty in the world. And I've been to the worst genocides, Cambodia. I've been in the middle of a shootout in the Colombo airport and taken hostage for 24 hours. I lived in Indonesia, so I saw the death squads killing my friends there, the Indonesian friends. And I'm here to tell you that I've never seen anything that's broken my heart in my life. I arrive when I'm 33 years old, and I meet Royce. And what I'm seeing in the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, which is 6 hours north of here in a comfortable drive to South Dakota, again, I'm in Boulder, Colorado, the heartland of America, can't compare to anything I've seen in India. I mean, in certain regards, the system is so cruel. It's so amazing that they're still alive. There's really nothing, any physical law that these people are still alive, as that we know as the Lakota people. It must be just purely what's left of the spiritual powers feeding their starving cells. And now they're under the assault of pharma and the Indian health services. So by the time the early 70s come, there's just murder after murder, just horrible murders happening on the reservation and around the reservation, that, and in Minneapolis, the city removal Indians, where they say, we've got to do something. We've got to do something. We've got to somehow renegotiate with Washington. Every treaty is being broken. It's not just that they're being broken, but you know, we're suffering under human rights atrocities, war crimes. Everybody's dying. You know, the infant mortality rate, the greatest in the Western Hemisphere. The oldest male, the 40. Everybody's just dropping dead. You know, it's one big, huge process of funeral, burial, graveyards, now under the Catholic Church and the Jesuits. So let's go, in long story short, let's head to, the Pine Ridge. That's the historic Wounded Knee. That's the historic political and historic symbol. Let's head to that graveyard and pray to our ancestors. Long story short, in between 200 and 300, people, Indian people, they did. I suspect that the word movement, an American Indian movement, and the story of how that sort of got placed on top of the group that becomes a leadership, a traditional leadership. You're the strongest man, Russell Means, Dennis Banks, the Belcourt brothers, Buddy Lamont. What you guys tell us what to do, and let's get, So I'm very suspicious now of this word, the American Indian Movement, and its origins. That there are stories, I've heard them all, that it was the elderly women, but I think the people up there have been brainwashed. I don't know, I don't want to insult anybody, but what I know now about the CIA and our controllers, I very much suspect that the second you have the word movement in the 60s, this becomes legal somewhere, even though it's completely illegal. So I'm very suspicious, because I'm not so sure that any of them said we're a movement, a political movement. They certainly weren't militants. They certainly weren't terrorists. They were a group of men and women that were trying to save their children, their grandparents, each other. So they end up in a church, the church, behind the graveyard. And I've read to you the response from the US government. So when I arrived, now this doesn't end, despite the wiki pages that I've printed out, the Wounded Knee incident, which is laughable, which I can't read here. I don't think we have the time. I don't know what happened. The FBI's are, that it's shocking, but I could put a link up for that. It's shocking what you read. I just printed this morning, so that this is what they say happened, which has no resemblance. Then I don't, that's, you know, so they're called they're labeled militants, terrorists, and serial killers. What the FBI does indeed do is murder quite a few people that show up at the 1972-3 event of the occupation, which lasted 71 days of the occupation of the church. They just stayed in the church and asked press. They called in local press and said, please send a message to Washington. We need help. We need to be heard. So what they get back is what's happening in Syria right now, what's happening in Iraq, what happened in Afghanistan. That's what they got. Because those are the very forces and units, by definition, and I've got all this printed out, of what SOGs are. This is printed yesterday, JSOC, and that's the final part of the presentation of what they got and why that is the war that nobody knows about. Even if it's covert, we still know about El Salvador. That was covert. But nobody knows about Pine Ridge. So it doesn't end until 1986. Now, the tanks are withdrawn mid-70s, 76. When I first married Royce in June 1994 and lived there for a year, there was nonstop flyovers of Hueys and, you know, F-35s and Formate, you know, nonstop. There were feds and CIA everywhere. There's militarized police still everywhere. In 1993, every house you go into, which usually has 30 or more people, several generations, because there's way underfunded housing. There's, for everyone person out of a population of 25,000, there's a tenth of a house available. That's, you know, so that's called housing. And even then, it's, I wouldn't call it housing. I wouldn't put my dog in one of those. So I arrived and start living there in 1994, and everywhere I go to visit with Royce on our projects, you know, ongoing, because we're now working together and married. It's common to see the, you know, oh, let's go see the elder over there. And you walk into a bullet riddled from the. So in the first year alone, 69 political assassinations, a total of just below 300. In the first 3 years of martial law, a bloodbath. Wiki will tell you in this document, Wounded Knee Incident, that I printed out this morning, that my, the goons and the full bloods just had a terrible fight with each other. We had to send in some FBI agents to oversee it, law enforcement, because, you know, these Indians were going wild on each other. They all killed each other. There were some killings, but it's not our job to look into any of these never solved cases of the assassinations. And it's not our job, claims the FBI here and in other documents I printed out. This is between those goons and those traditional types that wanted to be, you know, Indian again, you know, keep their hair long and come back from the cities and start to remember their ceremonies that had been outlawed from 1891 to 1972, forbidden to a life term in prison if you were caught practicing any aspect of your spirituality, speaking your language, prison till 1972. So I hope I've put into context in that first hour and some that we did have a war in Native America. And one final element to this is, why are we talking about U.S. citizens? Because in 1924, an act was passed through Congress. This is called the legislative part of genocide, which then goes post Wounded Knee into the final, which is cultural and spiritual genocide. Back to 1924, we have Congress pass an act called the Indian Citizenship Act. Jurisdictional powers over every reservation by our law enforcement. But, oh, by the way, you're now Indian citizens and you can vote, although they weren't allowed to vote till 1951. And the Constitution defines them as 5/8 human today. So my sons, my beautiful, this is a picture of them when they were just little boys, you know, and it's not, I didn't dress, they did that, you know, this is them at a birthday party when they were little. I wasn't playing Indian. I've never played anything. This was not some game for me. So my sons are 5/8 human, Paul, and I'm sure you've never met a 5/8 human. maybe the ones in South America, you've met some 5/8 humans. 5/8 human, they're not like you and me. I mean, I don't know, have you ever met humans that are only 5/8 human by our U.S. Constitution?
Amazing, it's amazing.
Because I now know quite a lot of them. And actually, I find them to be remarkable people, considering they're 5/8 human, and I'm full human, intelligent than I am. They have intact integrity, a sense of morals, and a complete comprehension of spiritual dimensions we can't comprehend as white mainstream Americans. But they are 5/8 human. So it's my little boys who are now about to be 20 and 22. So because of the act passed in 1924, the Indian Citizenship Act, another trickery, you'll get to vote now, not for another 30 years, but you're still 5/8 human by the Constitution. Don't forget that. You're now U.S. citizens. So when I say there was a war in North America to U.S. citizens, I make my final point. So that's the wrap up of the history, the historic perspective of who I am. And when I arrived in 1993 and married, oh my God forbid, because I might add one thing about myself. I am the most law-abiding person, the citizen. I respect authority. I'm honest. I couldn't dream of, you know, I'll stop at the red light at 3 in the morning with no traffic, although I haven't been out at night in 20 years. But you know, I would. I couldn't comprehend. Even I can honestly say in all my life, I've never stolen. I can't contemplate if there was a dollar lying and I was hungry, you know, I'm not going to grab it and put it in my pocket. I just, that's the way I am. That's the way Royce is. Royce has never been arrested, though he's been kidnapped, beaten, tortured, starting age 13. He was 13 when Wounded Knee started. So he has incredible head damage and head injury and, you know, big scars and one eye. And he's been tortured by the FBI. It's all he knows. So So when I arrive and marry him, I am there, you know, I finally find a man, because I've been around the world 5 times in 5 years at one point in that work in Asia, and I'd met men everywhere, and I never fell in love. Ever. I couldn't. I don't know. I thought, well, I'll never meet a guy that that just, you know, was the way I was. And there he was. The day I met him, it instant eye contact. That, you know, it was this recognition. Same for him. So we get married, and we're gonna do good things. I'm gonna, you know, continue being a journalist and et cetera. And you know, he's incredibly brilliant. Was, because he's technically murdered. To what degree his body is still alive, I can't determine. But by now they have murdered him. So this is a Malcolm X, Martin Luther King combination. He really terrified them. He was so articulate, passionate. He had a presence where he didn't even have to speak. He could help you and me. Which is all I witnessed when I brought him to white America. For those that were already outside the box, it was sort of on contact and an instant, you know, the box opened up more. He didn't even have to begin to speak, but he would only speak in very short sentences and remained the quiet person in the room. And yet he was this massive, you know, fierce. And so all those qualities, softest, most compassionate, most dear, hugest hearted person, all in one body. I think it was his intellect and his ability to articulate both intellectually his people's struggle, together with his up and running genetic, the full bloodness of his Oglala Lakota-ness that they'd once assigned 1,000 white men to try to kill, that really, you know, the spiritual depth that he just walked, that he spoke in a certain way, our English language, in a way where that unlocked our conditioning. So he could define freedom in a soundbite, and I saw it happen. Once we moved to Boulder, which was April 1995, we moved to Boulder, Colorado. At the moment, he's meeting white people for the first time in white America, because he's now 34. And I will remind you that he never had any semblance of running water or electricity till he was 21. I mean, that was something he didn't even understand until he was 21, that first Indians are getting running water and electricity, the first ones. There's still plenty without that. So that's the man I marry. So when I tell my story, what happened to me? I had to put this into context, and now I can begin telling you. And I tell this to help other people. Now I can begin to tell the details of what happened in this 23-year period since I met him, and what we've gone through. So, do you have any questions that I should?
No, I don't have any questions. You're coming out of this at the perfect time, because people are finding out that the ruling elite are pedo-Satanists, and they're running the world like this. And the first thing that Trump did was he pulled the stops out of the Dakota protest. He said, full force of government, put the thing through. That's consistent. Last time we were in Colorado, actually, we came across the reservation, and I know the poverty that they're in because I've been on reservations in Canada. So we wanted to buy something. Well, we needed potatoes. So we bought potatoes and we got them home and we have a Geiger counter. And the potatoes were so highly radioactive, we had to get them out of the house immediately. So this is happening, and some Americans listening to this are going to say, no, this didn't happen. This can't be true. It is true. This did happen. It's historically documented. And we face up to this because it's happening to us now. Now we're the urban terrorists. They're, if you, we watched a, Lydia and I were talking about a presentation that was made through a news bud, Dr. Whitehead, is it Whitehead? Who is with the Rutherford Institute, found a film that was taken in a training program for the military and the police. The military and the police are preparing for urban warfare against us. Everybody that doesn't buy the program, everybody that's awake is the enemy. And they have the full force of the military, just like they did at Wounded Knee, just like they do doing now in Dakota. But we're the target now. So if you don't believe this happened to the Indians, you better wake up because it's happening to you. So I want to let Lydia get on with her own personal story and round out the 2 hours. Thank you, Lydia.
Yeah. Well, Paul, I'm not at all surprised that you just connected the dots, because I know you well enough now through watching your videos. You know, it's not like there's a spectrum. You either are awake or you aren't. It's just at this point. And your whole heart, you know, and we're one family, you know, that the people, all of us that talk with each other. And because what doesn't surprise me is that in raising of the video, that's exactly where I'm going next. So I didn't even discuss that with you before we began, because guess what the name of the operation that runs Global 2030, guess what the name is?
I don't know. It's just part of the Phoenix Project. What was the name?
Operation Garden Plot and Cable Splicer to Rex 84. So now I can begin to tell what we went through, because what we were under since 1998, and I can clarify when it went from surveillance and why it became a micro low intensity warfare just to my family in 1998, because that's what it's been. It's micro, and this is 3 million Americans today under micro low intensity warfare, which is what they're calling what they're doing in Syria right now, low intensity. Low intensity was El Salvador. Low intensity, Iraq did not stay in total low intensity. So we go into low intensity warfare under Operation Garden Plot as an individual family. And you and I now know that, and I have a couple of directives here that I think are landmarks. It was in the bill. I mean, this has been incremental, as you know, the boiling frogs scenario. But where we become, as a macro, the United States citizens and the global citizens, under low intensity warfare, and in a minute I'm going to add other words to that, is this once really highly classified document, now unclassified. And I was going to do a slideshow, but I think it's just important I don't interrupt my train of thought. This is PDD-62, signed into law, was classified by President Bill Clinton. So under Clinton's administration from 1992, if I'm getting the dates right, to 2000, I believe, what was the date? Yeah, because then we have George Bush, 2004, Obama, right. So what is legalized in this directive, which comes out, I printed the whole administration directives, and I can provide links for this. I looked these up, and I think all Americans need to know. I think these should be highlighted. This comes out of the 8 years of directives, because in this 8 years, some fundamental things change with President Bill Clinton, with the structuring and legalizing of, and remember I told you about the word SOG'S, the Special Operation Groups on Pine Ridge. They always have been part of JSOC, Joint Special Operation Command, since 1945. This is the, this is three combination, this is a combination of three units of our special forces, the Green Berets, the Navy SEALs, and above them, the Delta Force, with the 82nd Airborne behind them right now today. This is called JSOC, Joint Special Operations Command. Now, I know you're not new to this, because I've seen your video with Dr. Eric Carlstrom, the endless acronyms and bureaucracy. We would never know that SOG isn't some esoteric, remote, exotic force just used on Pine Ridge if I hadn't found this. Special Activities Division. This is printed yesterday. Who's heard of this? So, but this is crucial. The Special Activities Division is what links the FBI to the CIA, domestic and global, up and running in 192 countries now. The US is the 192nd. If we didn't know how JSOC, which is a secret army, the FBI's secret wars, as exposed by Dana Priest in this infamous article, I found it 3 years ago, this is the Washington Post, Top Secret America, a look at the military's Joint Special Operations Command, JSOC. And I'll read just briefly, I didn't highlight, the CIA's armed drones, this is written in September 20th, 2011. The CIA's armed drones and paramilitary forces have killed dozens of al-Qaeda leaders and thousands of its foot soldiers. But there is another mysterious organization, we don't even know about this, that has killed even more of America's enemies in the decades since September 11, 2001 attacks. CIA operatives have imprisoned and interrogated nearly 100 suspected terrorists in their former secret prisons around the world, we know as rendition program, but troops from this other secret organization have imprisoned and interrogated 10 times as many, holding them in jails that it alone controls in Iraq and Afghanistan. It goes on, it's a long article, it's worth a read. I'll tell you where I started connecting dots. It was only 4 years ago. And it wasn't just that I started connecting dots. The final, I will call it kidnapping, of my husband had occurred. He was now gone. This is 4 years ago, roughly. And we know we're not going to get him back. And at that time, I processed that final grief. But I was also suddenly freed up. Because now I just had two sons. They've already, mind you, I had a daughter I haven't mentioned through all of this that was 5 when I met Royce. They got a hold of her within a year and destroyed my daughter. They. I lost a daughter. I fought for her till last summer, but she's programmed to kill me. So that may sound crazy and hyperbolic to the more conservative viewers, and I'll discuss that later. I'll discuss that later because I'm not being hyperbolic. I'm not hysterical. I'm not crazy. And this is documented. So I'm not going to talk about anything that isn't documented that I can't prove. But my daughter has been weaponized since she was about 6 and inducted behind my back into Satanism and raped and was assigned a handler by the time she was 12 in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and she's still under his. And there's a group around her of what I call the prison recruits that come out of... Bill Clinton's program, PDD-62, prison recruit system, which Bill and Hillary designed. So she is surrounded by a large number of coordinated, they've claimed her as family, that this is not some Patty Hearst, you know, because that in fact was a CIA op, as we all know. This is what they did to my daughter. So I can return to that tangent and should, because I need to keep focused on where it began with us going from surveillance, which now in hindsight, I understand starts the day I meet Royce. They've already analyzed me pretty well. They know I'm going to Pine Ridge. I mean, he always said that. And I'd be like, right, babe. I never quite took it seriously. I think there were reasons when I should have. I just never could wrap my mind around it. And I, you know, had some trauma I arrived with, both from, you know, personal childhood, serious trauma from my childhood, and my work in Asia. So I was, you know, so trauma worked well, and they used it with incredible precision as a weapon of me against me, what I couldn't or wouldn't see when it was right in front of my face. But let me return to the primary why 4 years ago did I start connecting dots. It begins after he leaves. Not that I haven't been on the internet for 10 straight years doing the study you've been in. We've, you know, whether it's the deep history of these families and the occult history of our world, which involves, you know, some scripture study, not in any biblical sense, but looking at the Bible as a researcher, and the Quran and the eschatological religions and the other religions as a researcher. So the deep history, and of course there's the study of the military aspect, the medical aspect, the psychiatric aspect, mind control, MK Ultra, on and on. We've all done all that study, you know, with the advent of the internet. And so I've already have all that, but I'm still stuck in trauma 4 years ago, and I'm still under attack. There's been some insane, you know, I can get to that later, recently. And now I've had terminal illness for 20 years, and I'll get to that. And they can't seem to kill me. So, it's obvious that keeps surprising them, but they're trying to kill the remaining 3. It's me and my sons with everything they've got, but I'm no longer afraid. And, I think they know that, and I think it's over. And I think that this is my first ever telling of my story going public, other than the article I wrote for SGT report in the fall regarding Pizzagate. So the thing 4 years ago that started clicking in my head really starts with a documentary regarding a colonel by the name of James Steele. I don't know if you've seen that one. First by Al Jazeera. I recommend it. We should put a link up for it. He's one of these. And so these guys are always, they're in every 192 countries. You start with a colonel. In Vietnam, and they always look just alike. It's the same clothing, holding the gun the same way. It's always the same kind of gun, same Ray-Bans, same kind of haircut. So today what we have, who we have running DynCorp and the global rat lines is General Grange and his son, who's also a colonel. So I want to say first that wherever you go in this world, which I'm discussing, you're going to run into the colonel. The colonel that comes from Canada that no one's ever heard of. These guys that run our special ops forces, our death squads, and open them up for rat lines to child pedophilia, trafficking, human trafficking, you know, first to organ harvesting since up and running since Kosovo, 1992, full-blown global infrastructure for organ harvesting. And then we can start moving the black market of oil, drugs, and guns, and anything else that might occur to them to run on the black market, and use the funnels, they call them funnels, which are the illegal money laundering schemes all over the world, ultimately always ending up at HSBC Bank. So, there's one word that kept coming up over and over besides colonel, because I had this imprinted in my memory. I never opened this book till after that documentary 4 years ago. And I married the man. This is his book. I never opened it until 4 years ago. I was too afraid. So the word that's even more important than colonel that started my final dots that leads me to today to hear to you is the word police. So there's this a very incredible story documentary, which now a world news has done a 50-minute piece about Colonel James Steele. James Steele has two episodes we are allowed to know about. He is the colonel in charge of El Salvador. So he gets 50,000 to 75,000 El Salvadorans in the same model of the goons to perpetrate they are the death squad. And then there's a group of words from there that started popping into my head, because I've already have memory imprints from Royce of some of these words that never had a dot to connect with. Low intensity warfare. And now I learned by myself another one, asymmetrical warfare. But this is the one with the big imprint that had nowhere to connect. Counter insurgency. And then urban warfare, non-conventional warfare, the realm and purpose of JSOC and SOG'S, which SOG'S didn't go away with Pine Ridge. SOG'S just landed in Syria. SOG'S are in Iraq. SOG'S are all throughout. We're in 192 countries. So are the SOG'S. So we might think that's some old archaic, you know, early formation of special operations. No, SOG'S, as defined, and I do have another, I have a wiki printout of SOG, but as defined here, and I did have slides, but I don't think I'm gonna be able to pull them out, that I can I can just read one line, the second page of the, you know, printed yesterday, what is JSOC's wiki? JSOC has an operational relationship with the CIA's Special Activities Division, the SAD. SAD, which is Special Operations, remember I said we have to know about this, Special Activities Division links the FBI to the CIA. It somehow makes this legal. And this begins before 9/11. This begins in 1992 with Bill Clinton's directive. That's actually not signed until 1998, but they go ahead and start using the model as soon as he gets in office. So SAD's Special Operations Group often recruits from JSOC. There you have it. And now we have in Special Operations Activities printout that it is the combination of Special Operations Group, printed yesterday, the Special Operations Groups, the same ones that were on Pine Ridge, is the department within SAD responsible for operations that include high threat military or covert operations with which the U.S. government does not wish to be overtly associated. The death squads I grew up under, I was born in 1958. You know, the wars you and I know since we're born, the post-World War II. Nothing new about SOG. It's been illegally up and running with me as eyewitness in Pine Ridge since Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. But we know that the earlier versions of it are the SAO, Rockefeller Secret Police, the Pinkertons, starting in 19, you know, turn of the century. FBI is formed in 1908. So there's, of course, always a special military, paramilitary, you know, with every empire, covert force to protect the emperor and his assets, you know, whatever era of this age of empires, 6,000 to 9,000 years old now. So, but there's that law, and we have to, you know, we have to follow the law they make up for us, but we're in trouble with the special forces of the U.S. military. They're heading your way down your private rural road. Oh my God. I don't mean to be funny here. They came. They did. We still live with these guys. We live under them. They're around us. So with that, the connection I started making is this word police. Police counterinsurgency. That's 4 years ago. 4 years later, here I am. I had to go through a process of untraumatizing myself, but I also, the timing had to be right, and it's taken some time. It's taken 4 years to start the research, the body of which is a huge amount of research, is on a computer I have that has extra memory. It's a $4,000 Dell. It's all that research is on that Dell, and my, just plugged it in the day before yesterday to help me with this interview, and it just seems to have gotten all virused up. And it hasn't even been plugged in. It's stored over it. But, oh, you know, it's not operable. But it has the 4 years of research where I begin this journey. And I began researching the special agents that have been in my life. And I either start with the rest or I finish with this point. What happens by the time Royce and I moved to Boulder in 1994, where I'm going to pursue a master's degree in transpersonal psychology at Naropa University, I was a semester away from graduating from the BA department, bearing two babies along the way with a 4.0 average and beloved, before I was expelled. So I got expelled. But that's 1998. So what really happened in 1998, where we went from, and this is where I end phase one of telling you the story and begin the personal details. You know, so how much time do we have left?
Well, we had kind of decided to go about 2 hours. You're about 10 minutes away from 2 hours.
Okay.
I think that we need to do more interviews.
Okay.
Subsequent interviews.
That's so good. It's a very
good thing. Honest to God, Lydia, I knew this would be an amazing interview. I knew it would blow people's minds. I know it's going to elicit strange comments, but the people who are awake are going to see this, and they're going to know that we're speaking truth, especially you. And we will go on. We will do more interviews, and we will flesh this whole thing out, and we will get that $4,000 download and continue with this. So if you want to continue or if you want to wind it up, whatever, you pick.
Well, I would be really happy to do a second part, and that is our personal story, which I call 1998 to 2017, still ongoing. I'm hoping going public, you know, and with everything I've heard, Dr., your techno crime fighters group, all five of those women coming up with ideas. I know in going public and taking a stand, getting proactive, it does stop it for certain categories, and that would be my category. So I have come to realize that this is where it stops for me. And I think it's important to do a second interview because this was a lot of information the first 2 hours, and I was practiced to put it all into 2 hours with the personal story. But I think it's really important to hear the personal story, 1998 to 2017, because I see that the other women, God bless their hearts, suffering and being tortured to death, are 4, 5, 3 years into it. And here I am into my full-blown 20 years since they went not only beyond just surveillance and to where JSOC, and I've written a paper, maybe I could, you know, talk to you about publishing. I'm not sure where to publish it, called Lydia White Calf, The Story of the White Calf Family, : Counterintelligence, JTTF, JSOC, ? Which one? All three? That's the title. And that's so if you want to do a second interview, because, you know, how I've heard that less than 1%, I've heard this from an insider, less than 1% survive, let alone into 20 years. So there's something unusual that I did that Catherine Austin Fitz did. And that's really why that's really what motivates me to reach out to you. Not my self-survival, you know, that's not why I'm doing. I've always only ever thought about, you know, one value, which is to help others, help all of us. So when I tell the personal story and what I did do, why I'm still alive, why I'm 20 years into, you know, active military assault, not just surveillance, targeted by military. I'm the sole Afghani in Afghanistan. They haven't killed me yet. It's seriously. And I wanted to really highlight one final thing. So, and I'll tell you up front, I noticed something immediately, and I already sent this to Catherine Horton in the original email when I first contacted her. She then put me in touch with you. I noticed when I found your channel and heard the other stories, not just hers, and I wrote this to her, so that's dated, and I said, there's something going on here. And then I heard Dr. Carl Erickstrom say, this was 10 days ago, when he was reading two out of the Mark Rich book, he used in those endless list of acronyms, he comes up with PSYOPS products. So, and again, I was going to do slides. I have a different PSYOPS product than the other women you're talking to. And I think that's part of the, if we do a second half, you know, take a few days, whatever. And with my personal story, because it's absolutely unbelievable. It's not just five James Bond movies. You know, it's 20 years. It's so help multiply that by 365 days. It's that many, 20 years, 365 days of Jason Bourne movies. Cause it's a 24/7. I'm still here. I'm still alive. My sons are still here. My sons are still alive. This was our PSYOPS product. I realized since I heard that word on your interview, that's why I want to share in a second half and you know, an hour and a half, whatever, easy. Because the hard part was this interview. The hard part was all this technical information, history. It was very dimensional. So I really think that would be, if you would be willing to do a part two of, you know, this, my story, that's where I tell everyone. And I keep pointing to the wall because I have this giant piece of white paper where I, like a detective, have listed every person. And that's a point I was going to get back to a few minutes ago and didn't. Every organic relationship in my life, and I'm on my finishing statement, every organic relationship in our lives, family, friends, neighbors, appeared from 1993 to 1998 as normal people. They were not. Our family was, on both sides, Royce's family was murdered off. So all my brothers and you know, this great family, I finally have a family. They were wonderful. They all dead. So I've got a list of this long of the murdered, the suicided, and the deceased in 20 years and assassinated. And then it's so the vacuum is created. You think that's your son's godfather. You think that's our best friend, Kay. You think that's, you know, you're surrounded by, no. And I have the proof and I have printouts, et cetera, who these people were and just how giant the map of humans, 20 years is what I keep pointing to that I need to redo to present electronically. Right now, it's just a giant detective map. It's probably more than 70 people. That is what replaced what would have been organic relationships. And my personal family work for them. So it's been, so not only did I lose my family, who are already not very functional, but we've been in a vacuum without realizing that this is what I began to put together 4 years ago, along with counterinsurgency police, is that none of these people were real to the last. There wasn't one, oh, okay, come on over. Oh, wolf, you know, not one hippie, I don't care what color, sex, age, costume, they're federal agents to the last, working for the JSOC program, or do we call it counterintelligence, JTTF? Not one. So I've got this giant, giant map of people with five places, and you'll be surprised to know, Paul, guess where I'm led? Guess, so this place is always leading me and surrounding me with this. But guess who I know? Guess where I end up in London in 2010? Are you ready? You'll be surprised at this connection. Where
yeah,
they?
Sure.
Belinda McKenzie.
Whoa.
Yeah, see? Yeah, there I am at Belinda's. When I get listed on the global internet, and I'm never out for, I was always the photographer. I don't want any attention. I don't want my face. I'm accused, and she helped this happen by the man I'm there with, who I worked with. His name is Kevin Annette. He got me to go on his behalf. to Belinda's house. I'd never heard of her. I didn't know who's Belinda. We go to London. This is 2010. This is one day in the Jason Bourne. All of a sudden, I'm tricked into sent out on the street of London reading summons to the Pope and his historic visit 500 years later, 2010, Pope Ratzinger, summons that the Pope must respond to the summons of war crimes to First Nations children. I'm tricked into reading it. And the day after, up goes my name over the global internet, five continents, this huge group Kevin Annette now has, co-opting the truth movement, Australia, Canada, North America, Europe, Eastern Europe, Lydia Whitecalf Black Ops. She's COINTELPRO. She's MK. So at that time, I did want to start to go public and do work again. So I end up curled up in a bed for the next 3 years in trauma.
Yeah, we got taken by Kevin and that too.
What?
Until Alfred Lieberman Weber exposed his things, and there were people from the First Nation who also did a podcast about Kevin and what a fraud he was. Melinda found out about Melinda through the Hampstead cover-up.
Exactly.
She was working against Ella and Abraham.
Right.
They're all around. And yeah. That's why working with TIs and people who have had their children taken by pedophilia, you don't know who to trust. You have to really, I don't know how to get around it, but they're everywhere.
They're everywhere.
And the people that we're working with now, the TIs, if you go through, we call it shameless torture, I think is the name of the video we did, interviewing Romola D.
Yeah.
Romola's neighborhood.
I saw the video. I watched Romola.
The mailman. I mean, it's all around. So,
in fact, Paul, I watched, that was the third video of yours that I watched, and my sons can tell you that I went into a 24-hour, they had to help me, PTSD episode from Romola's story.
Yeah.
I did. I was just, you know, so.
She's so powerful, and she's really coming on now.
I can't wait for her.
She's in full harness, and we've got her working.
Yeah, she's amazing.
Let's end this episode.
Yeah.
And I'll promise my Pineconeutopia subscribers that we will do another one, and we'll do it soon. Soon as you're organized and you've got yourself together. And if you need technical help, Mindy's here. And also, we've got a technical person who works with us out of South Carolina who will, I'm sure, love to help you get that together. Before we go, I want to say to my subscribers, not my subscribers, the people listening to this, I want you to subscribe to this channel because we're uncovering things that nobody else is going near. And I don't think that's because we're bold or fearless or anything. We're just being led to that. And really the stuff we're uncovering needs to be out there. We need to put it on Facebook. We need to spread it around. We're gonna try to find other platforms in addition to YouTube. But we have to get this out. This is just too important. And we're down to the wire. We are down to the wire here. You've got to wake up or we're going to be gone. So with that, I want to thank Lydia Whitecalf.
Thank you.
And what can I say? Thank you very much. And we're going to be back with more episodes, guaranteed.
Thank you so much. Thank you to you and Mindy.